Hello, I'm Ruth Sherlock, and welcome to the Life Alongside Mental Health podcast. This programme is part of the Strong Young Minds Together Festival, which celebrates the skills of Strong Young Minds, or SYM, champions. These young people are working to create awareness and understanding of mental health in the communities around them. They're supported by the Strong Young Minds Project and the CLD, Counselling, Learning and Development Trust in Hereford. The idea for today's podcast comes from Gabby Castle, who's been a SYM champion for 4 years. In this programme, we're going to look at the ways in which people build their lives and thrive alongside mental health. And so much of what you're going to hear is truly inspiring. Here's Gabby explaining a little more.
Okay, so we're here today to talk a little bit about improving your life alongside wellbeing. Now, what does that actually mean? Well, improving your life alongside wellbeing basically means all the little things that you can do on a day-to-day basis just to add some joy or some excitement or just some passion just to make life a little bit more enjoyable. So maybe it's being in nature, maybe it's a hobby or watching or playing sport, or maybe baking's the thing for you. Now, we're targeting this at the moment during the lockdown with the pandemic because we know that especially when life gets stressful or hectic, these things can quite easily get left behind because you can become so focused on just trying to get through the moment. However, adding these little bits of positivity into day-to-day life can really help lessen the stress and make things more manageable. Or, in the words of the Dalai Lama, happiness is not something ready-made, it comes from your own actions.
Gabby spoke with 23-year-old Lee Barrington about some of the ways that they find joy in their lives.
We thought it'd be nice to explore this further. So, Lee, how do you do this? What sort of activities do you do?
Yeah, so I like to engage in hobbies that I enjoy. Mostly for me, this is the keyboard, drawing, and going for walks in nature, especially along the riverside. And I also make sure that I visit my friends and family quite regularly.
Oh, that sounds really nice. It sounds like, again, it sounds like a really good variety. Do you have any sort of favourites, like a top two?
I guess my top two would be definitely the keyboard. I mostly do the keyboard in the evening as well, after a long day especially, because I find that it lifts my stress, whatever stress I've experienced that day, it just takes me to a different place. The other thing I love to do is go on walks, especially if it's with a friend.
Okay, yeah, I get what you mean. So obviously you've highlighted what you're doing at the moment. Do you have any plans on things you'd like to do in the future or things you'd like to expand on? Or?
Yes, definitely. One of the things I want to do next is go to college to do hairdressing. I think it's really important to do a job that I love and work somewhere that I can express my creativity. I also think it's important to incorporate things that I enjoy into my everyday life, as it uplifts me and makes day-to-day things easier and more enjoyable, which can lead to a feeling of fulfillment.
Yeah, that's true. And I guess that's exactly what we mean, really, isn't it? It's like you said, it's all about doing the little things that enrich our lives. So do you have any tips or things that you'd like the people that may be listening to this to hear?
Yeah, I guess my advice for other people would be to try new things, even if it feels silly. You never know, you might find something that is right for you. When I first started playing the keyboard, I thought I was too old to learn and I thought that I would be terrible, but now I couldn't be without it. So what about you, Gabby? Do you have any hobbies you enjoy or things you do to keep your well-being?
Yeah, so I think the first thing that comes to mind is something that I know some people may sort of look at and think is quite out there, but for me, doing sort of breathing exercises, like mindfulness and meditation, that sort of thing, for me can be really, really useful. I can find if I get sort of caught up in a moment or if I've had sort of a really hard day, then just sort of taking a deep breath and sort of focusing on my heartbeat or on something specific around me can really help kind of center me and kind of bring me back down. I also find singing to be quite good. I've enjoyed singing for as long as I can remember. And I think partly it sort of helps me kind of express myself. I'm not entirely sure what I'm feeling. But it is also something that just kind of makes me feel good. And yeah, I think lastly, the big one is sort of speaking to friends and family. It can just be about anything random, or it can be about anything that I'm struggling with, but it definitely sort of adds as an outlet, I guess. But also, it helps bring enjoyment, because there's absolutely nothing like sort of ringing up, you know, especially sort of younger family members, like children. There's nothing like ringing them up and seeing their smiley faces and hear them get all excited and enthusiastic about the things that they've done in their day.
Yeah, I agree with you there, actually. I think especially with talking to family members, it can be quite uplifting. And those are all things that can improve your mood and bring you to the here and now. I think it's great that you do mindfulness. Maybe it's something I can try to improve my well-being. So what about you? Do you have any ideas for your future?
Yeah, so I think a lot of mine seem to centre around sort of adding variety to my day-to-day life. So I love going for walks, but I tend to do, you know, like the same sort of couple of routes. And I'd quite like to start sort of exploring and just seeing new places, seeing, you know, new bits of nature and stuff. Another way I'd like to expand on what I'm already doing, I guess, is by joining a choir, because I love things where you get a sense of community with other people, I guess. And I love singing, so why not combine it, really? So yeah, overall, I think just sort of continuing doing the stuff I'm doing at the moment, but also making sure I add more variety into day-to-day life. So sort of changing when I do things, what sort of things I do, meeting up with friends, especially now restrictions are lifting.
There were so many great examples in this conversation about how we can look after our mental health, especially during these strange pandemic times. Walks, mindfulness, friends and family, and music. Gabby spoke about how important this is to her. Here she is, singing.
Oh, I hope you're dancing in the sky, and I hope you're singing on the angel's choir, and I hope the angels know what they have. Our bed is so nice up in heaven since you arrived. So tell me.
Next, we're going to hear from a man who shows just what you can achieve when you really put these methods, these ways of finding calm, health, and joy in your life, into practice. Leo Brooks is 26 and a final year student at Oxford Brookes University. A few years ago, he was diagnosed with rapid cycling bipolar disorder with drug-induced psychosis. His life went into a tailspin. He was just 19 and studying computer science at Birmingham University, but his condition there made it impossible for him to continue there. I reached Leo on a slightly scratchy phone line and we dived straight in. What are you studying now at university?
It's psychology and philosophy.
Oh, interesting. And what inspired you to choose that degree?
Madness. Yeah, so when I went mad, I was flipped. 10 out of 10, gone insane. I was not well. I thought I was Jesus. I was going to save the world. There were shape-shifting Illuminati ninjas coming out of the shadows.
Shape-shifting Illuminati ninjas?
Yeah, wow. Yeah. I know, it was bad.
Leo says he would play video games and see the stories in them as a real test for the human race. He says he knew all along that these games and the hours he spent scrolling Facebook were bad habits that he needed to get away from. Some days he felt like he was wasting his life away. And then New Year's came around, and Leo decided this had to stop. So he made some resolutions, a lot of resolutions.
I went raw vegan, I quit drugs, I quit video games, I quit a number of other habits that were sort of like not healthy. I started going out for walks every day and just trying to eat good food and whatnot, and that was a big change around.
It's not easy to change a habit, even if you're not dealing with all the things you were dealing with. I mean, how do you find the strength to do these things? I mean, those are pretty dramatic life changes.
Well, when you're stuck in a hole, your entire life is this tumultuous upset of voices and shadows and highs and lows. Yeah, you have a choice. You sort it out or you die.
Oh. And did you have support from family, from friends?
Yeah, no, I must give a lot of credit to my mum and my family. I was no one wanted to touch me with a 30-foot long barge pole, but my family were sort of very accommodating, very loving, and very unconditional. That had I been less fortunate to not have them, I would not have. I probably wouldn't have come out of it, honestly.
Within this space that his family had created, Leo had the time to think and process. He'd take himself for long, quiet walks in woodlands. And then he'd come back home and do research online, learning more about his condition. He says before you can build the life that you want, you have to get rid of the parts that you don't want.
I was going out drinking every night. I was out with people I didn't really like. I was doing things I didn't like. I was being a person I didn't like. And then there was this one night where all these stimuli were in just the right order for me to realise, no, I don't want this. This is categorically not what I want.
Leo started getting up early, sometimes at 5 or 6 in the morning, and would run for hours.
Yeah, I was getting, making good progress. I was losing weight. I was having a load of self-respect that I never had before. I was getting respect from other people as well. That was a new thing. Never had respect from other people. And I was being able to go out and achieve a lot more in life.
Yeah, because you've managed to do so much. You know, you then re-enrolled for university, which is a pretty big thing to do. Why do you think it's important to build a life alongside mental illness?
I don't like to remove my mental health from who I am. Like, if I'm depressed, that's because of my life. That's because of me. It's because of the people around me. It's because of random situations. It's because of what I've created, whatever. But at the end of the day, my mental health is me. It's inseparable. It's indivisible from me. So it's, you can live a life with mental health and not try to build a life. And it's understandable because if you have mental health issues, the severe ones are terrifying. But in the end of the day, it's you who's losing out. It's your family is losing out. It's your friends losing out. It's the opportunity you have to create a life is there, and if you seize it, you win. If you don't seize it, you lose.
To me, Leo's recovery seems especially remarkable for how he's managing to do all this without any medication.
Oh yeah, no pharmaceuticals. None.
He says he was put on antipsychotics at one point.
It just felt like a bit of me was dying off. There was a part of my brain that was being cut off from functioning. And I said to the psychiatrist, whoever it was that gave me them, I said, I don't want any more of those. I do not like that. So I'd rather sort of have my mind working in all its horror and work with it and try work through it, because my view on medication is, I don't want to say it's blanket bad. I don't want to say it's blanket bad for everyone, because there are some people out there who it makes sense for them in their life narrative to take it and help them get through something and to then deal with it at deal with issues at a more appropriate time. But my point of view is, if you can get by without taking it, and you can find another way, do that. And, you know, waylay your personal endeavours, because if you sort of waylay your mind with your personal endeavours, that is going to come back and bite you in ways you don't want to imagine.
And this is really Leo's main point. To live your life alongside mental health, he says, you have to address your mental health.
I spent a lot of time trying to sort of fit into molds and sort of be someone to someone, or force a way to be a certain way, or try to ignore who I am, my experiences, my thoughts, or all that. That never works. That might get you by a certain time, but you got to accept it. You got to accept in your own mind, and you've got to learn to talk about it.
Leo spoke a lot about why tackling your mental health head-on, recognising the challenges you face, is so important for being able to live a full life. This is also true for Jess Ryan Phillips, who, after struggling with eating disorders for years, has decided to take on these demons, or dictators and agents, as she calls them. A few months ago, she started a blog, and if you have a chance to go and look at it, you really should. She's already getting messages about it from people around the world. You can find it at winningatdinner.wordpress.com. Jess is a childhood friend of mine. We went to school together and had adventures together. Here's us catching up. So for our audience, Jess, tell me a little bit about yourself.
I'm Jess, and yeah, we've known each other for a long time. I work in Oxford, doing sort of research, finance and administration. I'm 33.
You've been dealing with anorexia. When did that start?
The first time these issues probably came about was in my teenage years, which is, I think, extremely common, particularly for young women, but for, you know, for anybody of any gender. And since then, that's been sort of 20 odd years of then going back and forward between sometimes being in a very restrictive phase, sometimes being sort of in different phases of sort of bulimia, or occasional sort of binge eating and things. So I like to swing around between all of the different disorders.
It's also remarkable how much you've achieved alongside that. Like, how do you do that? Because I can imagine that, especially, well, I imagine that, you know, what you're going through must be so all-consuming at times. I don't know how you do both those things, you know?
It's fine balance. I think it's something that I'm now managing a lot better than I have in the past. I mean, because when I sort of changed careers from being a professional musician, which was obviously quite stressful and quite high kind of, yeah, high stress job, but I think it's really about finding the balance of your support network. And so now the reason that I feel like I'm able to do recovery in a much more sort of a proper kind of actual long-term way is that I've got support from family, from friends, from sort of various resources, charities online. I've got an incredible therapist. And so it's kind of about finding that balance of things that are really helpful and yet also being able to do enough. You know, there have been points when I've been signed off work completely, but actually I find it more useful to have a balance where I do feel like I can keep on my professional life, because it apart from anything else, it's just quite a good distraction sometimes to have to go and do your job and be in work mode, because, you know, you can't sit there for 8 hours a day thinking about anorexia and how much breakfast you've eaten when you've actually just got a job to do. So I've actually found that being in work has been really helpful. But also I think just taking that first step, which is incredibly difficult to do, of actually being open about it, is the thing that's given me enough space to carry on my life. Because when you're trying to hold your job down and you're trying to hold it together and you're trying to keep everything a secret from everybody, that just is kind of impossible. I mean, no one can carry that on long term. And as soon as you start to let people in and you start to let people help and you start to say, actually, I'm really struggling, that, you know, people can then offer you that support. Nobody can support you when you're not able to ask for it. And that's kind of the biggest thing I've learned from starting to blog and starting to write and talking to people about it, is that, you know, when you need help, and we all need help, like I definitely need help, it's there. You just, you know, you need to feel able to ask for it.
Yeah. And do you remember, I don't know if this was a gradual change for you, or if there was a particular moment where you kind of decided, right, I have to be more open about this situation.
I think probably the biggest turnaround for me was being hospitalised a few months ago for a week or so. And that was a real turning point, because there was no way that I was allowed to leave without a support network in place. And at that point, I was incredibly resistant. But, you know, it's like, if I want to be discharged and I want to get back to my life, I have to do this. I have to ask for the help. I mean, at one point I had FaceTimes 3 times a day for my meals with family and things.
Wow.
But that's what it takes. And that's, you know, the only way I was allowed to be let out. And that was, you know, it was difficult at the time, but I'm incredibly grateful for that, because that's literally the reason I'm still here.
You know, this festival is about learning to live alongside mental health and celebrating that, and also kind of thinking about why it's important to live alongside mental health.
I think, like, with any with any mental health difficulty or any diagnosis or any issue which feels like it's taking over your life, one of the things that's so, I think, kind of difficult to sort of to accept is that there is, you know, it can be incredibly encompassing. It feels like it's your whole life. But taking that step out and kind of looking at a bigger picture is something that's very hard to do, but I think it's absolutely key to recovery. And you've got to hold on to something that you care about more than whatever it is that's your difficulty, you know, whether it's sort of a feeling of obsessive compulsion or something that's making you feel incredibly depressed or anxious, or like for me, you know, basically compulsive behaviors to do with restricting food. I have to find something I care about more. And it's hard when you're in the middle of it to see what those things might be, but that's where, you know, you have a chat with someone, or like, I see you being such a great mum, or, you know, I realized that I could go out for dinner with a friend and that would be really nice. And all of those little things start to build a picture of a better and more grounded life that's not run by, you know, in my sense, what I call the tiny dictator, with some humor but some reality. You know, there's so much more out there, and we've all got the potential to sort of escape from that little bit of our head that feels like it's taken over. But it doesn't have to. We're all more than that.
And I think so many of us, like now, following your blog, I feel like I've, you know, you've taken the step of not just talking about your situation, but actually sort of letting. I feel like you've been brave enough to let people into your world so vividly through your blog. You know, I now feel like I know, I kind of have a sense of the tiny dictator.
And you totally do.
And like, talk me through some of the other characters. I mean, I know Amazing Therapist. There is...
Yes, Amazing Therapist is amazing. I speak basically mostly about the tiny dictator, who is basically the person in charge of... my continuous efforts to be smaller until there is nothing left. And the tiny dictator, I think my amazing therapist, as we know him, explained it very briefly and wonderfully the other day, that basically, you know, this person in your head would rather kill you than itself. So you just have to be aware of that. Like, you know, don't think you're fighting someone who might occasionally be on your side. Like, the tiny dictator is totally out for himself. So he's a big one. And then the other two main characters that I talk about are the one called Binge Brain. So Binge Brain is basically kind of what it says on the tin. It's about a feeling of lack of control. And then the other character, which is often connected to Binge Brain, is Agent Empty, which is probably my least favourite, actually, out of the three, which is, I guess, probably the connection to bulimia, or at least symptoms of bulimia, which is basically about purging. And it's something that I think also, you know, that's scary and that's horrible, but then part of the way to cope with it is to look at, well, there are light moments, you know, there are things that you can find funny and things that I can find ridiculous. And that's kind of, you know, particularly with Agent Empty, I like to try and almost for myself write about the more ridiculous things and feed that back to myself and say, Jess, don't you think this is an absolutely mad thing that you're doing? Does this actually really feel like something you want to do for your whole life? And sometimes as I write things out, I think, did I really do that? Like, that's absolutely insane. And sometimes it's kind of, that's actually quite a good therapeutic process.
Without...
To just kind of think, these are almost external characters. This is not me, you know, this is not what I call actual Jess. Because actual Jess wouldn't be like, I can't moisturize this morning because I've got to weigh myself for therapy and I might weigh more because I will put moisturizer on. But that's completely the kind of thing that the tiny dictator will tell me. You know, these characters they're very powerful, but they are also ridiculous. And so part of why I want to write about them in a slightly humorous kind of facile way sometimes is to say, you know, let's take them seriously. They threaten my life, but also let's look at them for how extreme and ridiculous they are. And let's try and loosen their hold. You know, we all have dictators in our heads of some sort, but they don't have to be the person with the whip in charge. They can be one of the many characters. It doesn't do anybody any favors for us all to be hiding it so successfully, because we all feel really alone. And actually one person being, you know, hopefully brave and opening up is if I can start a ball rolling and other people feel able to say, actually, yeah, I feel a bit like that, or even if I've just had a difficult day, or actually, I really binged today and I really wish I hadn't, or, you know, I feel a bit rubbish about myself, I wish I hadn't weighed myself. You know, all these little conversations that can start to happen, then that encourages people to be open and not have that secrecy that lands you in hospital.
It's so lovely, because it feels like you're saying that one way that what kind of helps you helping others is kind of what helps you in some senses,
yeah.
You know, which is,
yeah,
which is again going back to this thing of like taking yourself out almost of the, because as you said, these illnesses or conditions can be so all-encompassing that this way you're forcing yourself to step out of it, and I can imagine that seeing the response from others can be and the help that you're giving others by doing that must be really rewarding.
It really is, and it's, I think you've touched on an incredibly important thing there, for probably for all of us, but certainly for people who struggle with kind of feeling stuck in their own head for whatever reason, is that actually the act of helping someone else, you can't be selfish in that moment. You know, you can't be, because, you know, anorexia is a very selfish disease, and it makes you very selfish accidentally sometimes as a person. You know, I've done awful things for, you know, in the cause of Agent Empty and you know, the Tiny Dictator, but actually when you're helping somebody else, you're none of those things. You know, you are providing a service and being loving and kind. And, you know, in a way, almost like those characters can't touch you there. And we all have that capacity. Yeah. So, yeah, I think it's incredibly important. It should be a part of any recovery that it can, is to try and be involved with helping other people. It's just really validating. It's really touching and really lovely to feel like you've done that as well.
Yeah. Was Jess Ryan Phillips on the piano playing the theme tune from Amelie. In all these interviews, I've been struck by how, despite their personal challenges, and in some ways because of them, Gabby, Lee, Leo and Jess are all living such full and fruitful lives. Hearing them speak so openly and honestly has been an inspiration for me. Thank you for listening, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the festival. Goodbye.